it between the hours of 7 a.m. to 8 p.m.
And on student, my name is Peter Shen, a senior lecturer at the Department of Educational Foundations, University of Education, Winneba. As you heard earlier, the radio lecture this morning is for level 100 students studying the course Introduction to Educational Technology this semester, with the course code EDCR121. In today's radio lecture, we will look at the topic Behaviorism Paradigm and its application in education. Behaviorism Paradigm and its application in education. As you all agree with me that we were made to understand at our various lecture halls that the purpose of educational technology is to facilitate learning and improve performance. I believe you remember that at our various lecture halls with our various lecturers handling us at the beginning, when we were trying to let you understand the meaning of educational technology, it came out clear that the purpose of educational technology is to facilitate learning and improve performance. So if you are being introduced to educational technology and the purpose is to facilitate learning and improve performance, then you need to have knowledge about how people think about learning. So the topic for this morning, when we talk of a paradigm is a way of thinking about the real world or a way of looking at something. So when we talk of a paradigm, simply put, it's a way of looking at something. And the something this morning is learning, how people learn. So in education, educators have their own understanding of how people learn. Hence these learning paradigms. And there are three main learning paradigms. These are behaviorism, cognitivism, and then constructivism. You have these three main learning paradigms. All others were derived from these three. We have behaviorism, cognitivism, and then constructivism. So this morning we are going to focus on behaviorism. The behaviorists, those who believe in the ideas of behaviorism, are referred to as the behaviorists. So if I say behaviorist, I mean those who are in line with the worldview of behaviorism. And we cannot talk about behaviorists without making reference to some individuals like Watson, Pavlov, Skinner, and others. These ideas, this worldview of how people learn, what the behaviorists believe in, came up as a result of some experiments. For radio lecture, because we have 1 hour to go through all this, our focus will not be much on the experiment, but we are going to look at the general ideas that came out of these experiments. When we get opportunity to go through another general education course, Psychology of Human Learning and Development, Human Development and Learning or something like that, we will go deep into some of these experiments for you to have better understanding of those experiments that these behaviorists conducted to come out with these ideas. But for today, for this morning, we will look at the general view of the behaviorism paradigm and how we can apply it in education. Most educational psychologists see learning as a relatively permanent change in behavior due to practice and experience. What it means is that we can say that we have learned when there is a change in behavior, and that change in behavior should be relatively permanent. And we experience this change in behavior as a result of practice and experience. So when you read the ideas of many psychologists, you realize that when we talk of learning, it has to do with a change in behavior. Behavior change as a result of practice and experience. So learning is a process. Learning is a process. And learning involves all those experiences and training of an individual right from birth, which help him or her produce change in his or her behavior. And learning leads to change in behavior, but it does not necessarily mean that these changes always bring improvement or development in the positive direction. I'm saying that we are saying learning is a process. Through this process, as we go through practice and experiences, there should be a change in behavior before we say we have learned. But it's not always that this change is positive. Sometimes some changes are negative. But still, you have learned something. Some of you are here, level 100. When you came last semester, we saw you. Very innocent when you are walking, decent. But now, because you've seen your friends, your groups that you are with, some walk without the back of their foot touching the ground. So this time, unconsciously, you have copied them. So now when you are walking as if you are dancing, it's a change in behavior, but it's not positive. That is learning, yes. So that is the point, change in behavior. But not all changes that come are positive. That is the point that I'm making. And we learn to prepare us for the necessary adjustments and then adaptations. So when we are saying that, what we are saying is that most psychologists see learning as a relatively permanent change in behavior due to practice and experience. So if you go in for drugs and you put up a behavior under the influence of drug, that is not learning. Because when the drug is no more in you, that behavior will not be there. That's why we say relatively permanent change. All right, so that is the basis for learning. So now let's look at this behaviorism paradigm, the theories. When we talk of a theory, theories of learning, they explain how learning occurs. So the behaviorists, they are concerned with observable and measurable aspects of human behavior. Let's pick these two terms, observable and measurable aspects of human behavior. The behaviorists, they are concerned with the behavior, the observable behaviors and the behaviors that we can measure. That is the focus of the behaviorists. And they focus on formulation of what we call the associationistic principles of learning. I will explain that big term there. What the behaviorists believe in is that learning can occur when the right environment is created, when the individual is given the right guidelines to operate within the environment, associate with events in the environment, respond to events in the environment, and that change in behavior that we call learning will occur. So they believe in formulation of associationistic principles of learning. So to the behaviorist, changes in behavior that result from stimulus response associations made by the learner. Stimulus response association. That's why I said associationistic principles. When we say stimulus, a stimulus is any event which is perceived by the human sense receptacles. any event which is perceived by the human sense receptacles. We say that gateway to knowledge is through our senses. You know our senses. You know our sense receptacles. The eye, the nose, the tongue. I believe you are mentioning them. We hear, we see, we touch, we feel, we taste. So, any event that is perceived by these sense receptacles is what we are referring to as stimulus. So it can be visual event, it can be a sound, can be taste, can be touch, can be smell, can be combination of all these. And when we talk of response, the results from these events. When you are in the lecture hall and you hear a large sound, I believe everybody will react. Some will even somersault. Because based on your experiences, some may think that it's a bomb, others may think it's a different thing. So we react to events in the environment. And through reacting to events in the environment, that is the event in the environment that we perceive with our sense receptacles. That's what is referred to as the stimulus. Then whatever will come, the reaction that we put as a result of those events is what we call the response. So the behaviorists, to them, changes in behavior result from stimulus response associations. So for the behaviorists, they assume that the learner is essentially passive and then responding to environmental stimuli. And the behaviorists believe that the learner starts off as a clean sheet. And they use a technical term, what they call tabula rasa. That when we want to learn something, when we are targeting on a particular change in behavior, we start clean, we don't know. When the right environment is created, the right guidelines are given, and then the learner manipulates things within the environment. With the right guidelines, learning can occur. That is the broad idea about the behaviorism paradigm. We start as a clean sheet. What it means is that we can all learn. When the right guidelines, the right direction is given, the right environment is created. And to them, learners' behavior is shaped through reinforcement and punishment. So what the behaviorists are saying is that for learning to occur, there should be some kind of association between the stimulus and response. You create the right environment, the learner operates within the environment, respond to events within the environment, with reinforcement and punishment, that change in behavior that we refer to as learning will occur. That is the broad idea about the behaviorism paradigm. So to them, learners' behavior is shaped through reinforcement and punishment. So let's have a look about what they mean by reinforcement and what they mean by punishment. When we say reinforcement is any event that strengthens or increases a behavior that follows it. So when we say reinforcement, the focus of reinforcement is to strengthen or increase a behavior. And usually, we reinforce a desired behavior. When I say a desired behavior, what I mean is that a behavior that, let's take it that a behavior you expect. If you take it to our educational sector, in the classroom situation, you set targets for your learners, what you expect them to do, what you expect them to achieve. So when you realize that they are achieving the expected outcome, the expected behavior that you have set for yourselves, for them, that is the desired behavior. So we reinforce a desired behavior because that is what we expect them to put up. So reinforcement is to strengthen or to increase that behavior, a desired behavior. And under reinforcement, we have positive reinforcers, we have negative reinforcers. And whether it is positive or negative, the focus is to increase a desired behavior. I repeat, what I'm saying is that any event that strengthens or increase a desired behavior, that is what we refer to as reinforcement. And reinforcement, we have positive reinforcers, we have negative reinforcers. Whether it is positive or negative, the focus is to increase a desired behavior. Because the behaviorists are saying that the learner's behavior is shaped through reinforcement or punishment. Now let's look at what we mean by positive reinforcers. Positive reinforcers are favorable events. The word is favorable. Favorable events or outcomes that are given to the individual after a desired behavior is exhibited. Positive reinforcers are favorable events or outcomes that are given to the individual after a desired behavior is exhibited. So, in the classroom situation, a teacher expects that through instruction, through the teaching learning process, learners will contribute positively in class discussion. So if a learner should contribute positively, normally you hear teachers clap for him, clap for her, very good, nice one, keep it up. These are favorable things that are given after that desired behavior for contributing positively in class. So praises, sometimes those who have tangible things will reward those who contribute well in class. So the child will feel good that if I continue to do this, the teacher will praise me, the teacher will reward me. That's why I say a favorable event. So the learner, it's favorable to the learner. Everybody wants to be praised. Everybody wants rewards. We want good things. It feels good. So we put up the good behavior. That behavior that is expected, then a favorable event is added. That is what we refer to as a positive reinforcement. Why do we praise them? Why do we reward them? So that whatever good behavior that they put up, they will continue to be doing that. And as they continue to do that, that will bring about that change in behavior that we refer to as learning. So that is positive reinforcers, favorable events or outcome that are given to individual after a desired behavior is exhibited. When we talk of negative reinforcers, they are typically are characterized by removal of an undesired or unpleasant outcome after a desired behavior. When we say negative reinforcers, they are typically are characterized by removal of an undesired or unpleasant outcome after a desired behavior. So, let's go back to the classroom situation. Now, if in a classroom situation, let's say a teacher, you decide that if a child should do very well, contribute very well in the class. Maybe all the children are supposed to do some kind of cleaning, which the children, every child don't want to clean. It's not desirable. I'm just using it as an example. So if you contribute very well in class, that very day, you will not be part of the cleaning. You are removing that unpleasant event. In this case, we are using the cleaning. though others will argue that it's okay, it's part of the training. But in this wise, we are looking at it from the point of view of the learner. The learner don't want to do the cleaning. The condition is that if you do very well, contribute well in class, to class discussion, you will not be part. So those who contribute well in class, that unpleasant event of cleaning is removed. That is negative reinforces. So we are removing that after a desired behavior is put up. And this will encourage the child to continue to contribute in class so that that unpleasant behavior will be removed. He or she will not encounter that. And at the end of the day, the more the child continues to put up that desired behavior, that will bring about that change in behavior that I refer to as learning. So, reinforcement can be positive or it can be negative. But whether it's positive or negative, the focus is that it increases or it strengthens a desired behavior. So when it is positive, it means we are adding something pleasant after a desired behavior. That makes it positive reinforcement. If it is negative reinforcement, it means you are removing something unpleasant to the learner after the desired behavior is put up. So whether positive or negative, the focus is that we want to strengthen or we want that behavior to be increased. And the more we strengthen that desired behavior, the more we ensure that that desired behavior is increased, that will bring about that change in behavior that we refer to as learning. As we said, they believe that the learner's behavior is shaped through reinforcement and punishment. So now we have looked at reinforcement. Let's look at what punishment is. When we talk of punishment, it's a presentation of an adverse event or outcome that causes a decrease in the behavior it follows. Presentation of an adverse event or outcome that causes a decrease in the behavior it follows. So what it means is that whilst reinforcement will strengthen or increase a desired behavior, punishment will decrease an undesired behavior. We punish to decrease undesired behavior as we reinforce to increase a desired behavior. These are basic things that we should pick. Reinforcement is for the strengthening or increasing of a desired behavior. That is why we have positive reinforcement, we have negative reinforcement. Then punishment is to decrease undesired behavior. And punishment too, we have positive punishment and then we have negative punishment. And when we say positive punishment is when unfavorable events or outcome are given in order to weaken the response that follows. So you go back to our schools, gone were the days where if a child should put up a behavior which is not desirable, the teacher will be applying cane, which is unfavorable. Why do the teacher apply the cane to the child when the child puts up undesired behavior? The aim is to decrease that behavior, to make sure that the child will not continue putting up that behavior. The child will not do that again. That is positive punishment. The cane is not favorable to the learner. So when you add unfavorable events or outcome in order to weaken a response, then we call that one positive punishment. Now, when we talk of negative punishment is characterized by when a favorable event or outcome is removed after undesired behavior occurs. When a favorable event or outcome is removed after an undesired behavior occurs. That's what we refer to as negative punishment. So a child will put up a behavior that is undesirable, a behavior that is not good, let me put it in simple terms. Then something favorable to the child is removed. The child is denying something favorable. And because the child, that event that the child is denying is favorable to the child, and the child will not feel good losing that, will not continue to do whatever bad thing he or she put up for him to be denying the favorable event. So let's take the normal classroom situation. Every child wants to go out for leisure break. Because the child didn't put up the good behavior in class, the teacher denies that pleasure of going out to play. That is negative punishment. What is the focus of the teacher? Because the child will not like that leisure, that pleasure of going out to play, to be taken away from him or her, will not put up that behavior that caused that. And that is what we refer to as negative punishment. So punishment can be positive, punishment can be negative. But whether positive or negative, the focus is to decrease undesired behavior. When the Ghana Education Service came out to say teachers should not be caning, some teachers decided not to go to school again or not to even discipline them, which is totally wrong. It is not only positive punishment that we can apply when we want to modify behavior. There are different ways of modifying behavior. So if the authorities realize that applying the positive punishment was causing some damage to the learners, so we need to change the style, then there wasn't the need for that APRO, where people were even saying that then they are no more going to be interested in the discipline of the child, shaping the behavior of the child. It was unfortunate. Because for punishment, we can have positive punishment, we can have negative punishment. When we remove certain favorable event of the learner from the learner, when the learner should put up undesired behavior, it's a way of punishment. But that's why we are not applying any unfavorable thing which can cause damage to the child. So basically what we are saying this morning is that to the behaviorists, we all start as a clean sheet when we want to learn. What they refer to as a tabula rasa. We all start as a clean sheet. When the right environment is created, when we give the right guidelines for the learner to operate within the environment, and when we use reinforcement and punishment, we can shape the learner's behavior and learning can occur. And they are interested in the observable and measurable aspects of the learner. So that is what the behaviorists believe in. They believe that we all start clean when the right environment is created, when the right guidelines are given, when we realize that the learner is putting up the behavior that we so wish the learner should put up, the desired behavior, we reinforce. The more we reinforce, that will strengthen or increase the behavior. When we realize that within the environment, the learner is not putting up the desired behavior, the learner is putting up undesired behavior, what is not expected, we punish to decrease that undesired behavior. So reinforcement is for strengthening or increasing behavior, the desirable one, of course, whilst punishment is for weakening undesired behavior. So with this at the background, then let's look at its educational implications. One is that instruction should be provided gradually or little by little, from simple to complex, and the subsequent one should build on the previous one. We are saying that we create the right environment for the learner to operate within. And then we use reinforcement and punishment to... So we all start clean. We guide the learner. So when we are giving instruction, it should be gradual. We should present our information little by little. We should start from simple to complex. We can continue from near to far. And then when we are built, we should build on previous experiences. Don't forget, we said learning is changing behavior as a result of practice and experience. So we need to build on previous experiences. That is why, as a teacher, when you are preparing for your learners, you need to know what they know. So we have what we call RPK, relevant previous knowledge, because you are going to build on the previous knowledge. All right. Then also, materials to be learned should be arranged systematically and in a sequential steps. This one, if you even pick any of the subject curriculum that we have, you realize that concepts are arranged sequentially. You see topics now, you call strands and substrands in the new curriculum. They are arranged sequentially. You need to understand the first before you move on to the second. Then you move on to the third, because they need the knowledge from the first and the second to be able to do the third. So we need to arrange materials systematically and in a sequential steps from simple to complex. Then another educational implication is that students should be encouraged to progress at their own pace. The behaviorists are saying that we all start clean, let's create the right environment, let's allow the learners to operate within their environment, let's use reinforcement and punishment to shape behavior. But when you read more of the ideas, reinforcement should be used more than punishment. So we need to, as a teacher, you need to focus more on reinforcement than punishment. Because one of the things is that if you don't create the right interest, if you don't try and make the learner to be interested in whatever subject that you are facilitating, no matter the kind of punishment that you put up, that change in behavior that you are expecting, the desired one, will not occur. Because people need to understand why they are learning what you want them to learn. So though they are talking about reinforcement and punishment, as a teacher, your focus should be more on reinforcement. Let's create the right environment. Let's help them to be interested. Let's help them to be ready, to be eager. And when they are ready, effective learning will occur. So we should encourage learners to progress at their own pace. If you look at even the new curriculum now, we are talking about scaffolding, differentiated teaching. We are talking about scaffolding, differentiated teaching. This time we are not talking about if you have a large class and few of them are with you, your objective is to know. We are now talking about standard base. And we have standards that these learners should achieve. And within that period of time given, people who should be given opportunity to go according to their pace to achieve the standard set for them. So, differentiated teaching. Teachers should encourage learners' participation. We are talking about a change in behavior as a result of practice and experiences. So if people don't participate, if people don't practice, then we shouldn't be expecting any effective change in behavior, which is relatively permanent, for us to refer to as learning. They are saying, let the learner operate within the environment. Use reinforcement and punishment to shape the behavior. So learner participation is very much important. Learner participation. So if you listen to modern day educators, everything they will say learner-centered, active participation for any effective learning to take place. So teachers should encourage learners' participation. Then teachers should reinforce the behavior in their students which they wish to be repeated. We need to reinforce the behavior in our students which we wish to be repeated. Because we said reinforcement is to strengthen or increase a desired behavior. Then evaluation should be encouraged with prompt feedback. The learner is operating within the environment. You are using reinforcement and punishment to shape behavior. If the learner is participating, we are talking about encourage learners' participation. If that learner is participating and you are not giving feedback as to what the learner is doing is right or not, how will the person know whether the behavior he or she is putting up is desirable or not? So, prompt feedback should be encouraged. We need to give prompt feedback. And then another educational implication is that because we create the right environment for the learner to operate within, all artifacts which do not contribute to the mastering of the content should be screened out. You set targets for yourself in the classroom situation, then you need to create the environment so that things within that environment will help the learner to achieve the goal that you have set for yourself. So if there are things there that will take the attention and the time of the learner from achieving the expected goal, you need to do away with them. Let me give a typical example. You are a class teacher, lower primary, you go to some schools, one person is teaching all the subjects. So you teach math, you teach English, you teach whatever. Some are even teaching French and Latin. Jack of all trade, myself not. That's just by the way. So you teach everything. Now, you go, the morning you are going to teach mathematics. After mathematics, you are going to do science. You have some charts that you are going to use for the science. Before you start mathematics, you call the children to come and help you. You display these charts on the board close to where you are going to teach them mathematics. And as you are teaching the maths, you realize that some of the children will be focusing on what will be done after the mathematics. Divided attention. So nothing will happen. That's just an example I'm using to explain this point. So all artifacts which do not contribute to the mastering of the content at that time should be screened out. Because you need to create the right environment for them to operate within to achieve the desired goal. Then instructional objectives should focus on performance behavior. The more they do, the more they understand. The more they do, the more they understand. Later on, when we get to instructional design, we are going to talk about the cone of experience. And then you realize that the best way is the doing. Because when people are involved, when people do, they tend to remember 90% of whatever that was done. Unlike just listening to tests, just reading tests, no. So we need to make sure that our instructional objective should focus on performance behavior. So this and many more are some of the educational implications of these ideas from the behaviorists. The studio line, so we are going to open the studio line. The studio line is 0503-923158. 3158. You can also call on 0332 320201. You can text or WhatsApp on 0503 923 1 58. You can call, you can WhatsApp, you can text. You can also join us on Facebook, Radio Windy Bay 98.3 FM. Facebook, Radio Windy Bay 98.3 FM. You can also listen to us on the university homepage, www.uew.edu.gh. www.uew.edu.gh. So, the phone lines are now activated. So you can call for clarification. You can contribute, or you can ask whatever that you ask, you want to know about the presentation this morning. So let me just recap as we wait for your calls. Hello.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning. Your name and name, please.
This is Righteous Man from the Mathematics Department.
Beautiful. Yes. Your contribution.
Yeah. Thank you a lot for this coming lecture this morning.
All right. Thank you, too.
This, at the onset, you made us know just that the behavioralists are much concerned about the observable and measurable behaviors. So, I want to find out, aren't they concerned about the affective domain of learning, since that one is often not much more measurable and observable?
Beautiful, very good question. Yes, that is why some other people criticize the idea of the behaviorists. Don't forget that I said we have the three main. The modern ones, they built on the three main. We have the behaviorists who are only interested in the observable and measurable aspects of behavior. The other people, when you go to the cognitivists, they are much interested in what's happening in the brain. Because to them, we will do that in subsequent radio lectures. To them, before you put up any behavior, something has already occurred in the head. But that is not the focus of the behaviorists. To the behaviorists, whatever that we do within the environment, what we see, what we can observe, what we can measure, that change in behavior that we can observe, that we can measure, that is the focus of the behaviorist. So that is a good observation, yes. All right, so that is it. They are interested in the, that is why they say we all start as a clean sheet. Tabula rasa, we all start as a clean sheet. Now let's create the right environment. Let's allow people to operate within, give them the right guidelines. Let's use reinforcement and punishment to shape the behavior. All right, so you can still call 0503 923 158. You can WhatsApp, you can text on that line, 0503 923 158. You can also call 0332 320201. Join us Facebook page, Radio Windy Bay 98.3 FM. Also university homepage, www.uew.edu.gh. So we are waiting for your calls. Thank you. Hello.
Hello.
Yeah. Good morning.
Good morning.
Uh-huh. Your name and department, please.
My name is Management Education.
Okay.
Yes. Sir Blake, you said you were going to explain associationistic by reading.
Oh, it means no, I did. Only that you didn't listen well. I said we believe in stimulus response association. And I explained what a stimulus is. That those that we pick with our sense receptacles and the kind of reaction that we give to it, that is associating those events with the response.
Okay.
Yes, yes. They believe in the stimulus response association. So you respond to a particular behavior in a certain way, and the more you respond to that behavior in that way, that will bring about the change in behavior that we refer to as learning.
Okay.
Yes. Yes. Okay. All right. Thank you. We have someone who sent us a WhatsApp message. The name is not there, but the number is there. We have. Okay, good delivery, sir. Watching you from Ejumako campus, Eric Obuna Obo Fanti Unit. All right, thank you, Eric, for watching. Keep watching subsequent radio lectures. Thank you very much. Hello.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, hello. Please, people, come again, please.
Yeah, I want to know which people is concerned with the observable and measurable aspect of human.
We are talking about how the behavior is. See learning. Their worldview about learning. They are only interested in the observable and measurable aspects of human behavior.
Okay.
That is what the behavior, those behaviorism paradigm, the behaviorists.
Okay.
They are interested in the observable and measurable aspects of human behavior. So okay. To them, when the right environment is created, when the right guidelines are given, and then when people are putting up the behavior that we expect, we reinforce so that they continue to put up that behavior. When we realize that they are putting up a behavior that we don't expect, we punish to decrease that behavior.
Okay, sir.
All right, thank you.
Please can you help me with the meaning of stimulus?
Oh, you are not listening, right?
Yeah, like I just
came. Oh, you just joined?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, when we talk of stimulus, I said any event which is perceived by human sense receptacles, our senses. It can be visual events, something we see. It can be something we hear, sound. It can be something they taste, something we touch, something we smell.
Okay, sir.
So when we see, we react. That is the response we give. When we hear, we react. When we feel, we react. When we touch, we react. So that is what we call the stimulus response association.
Okay, sir.
Yes, yes, yeah.
Thank you a lot.
All right. Now we have some WhatsApp messages here. My name is Ekurapa Michael, Economics Department. I have noticed that my student is not academically good. I had put him in mechanic to learn mechanic. Hey. Am I being a good teacher? Oh, okay. I now get to your question. I've noticed that my student is not academically good. I have put him in mechanic to learn mechanic. Hey, that's where I went. Am I being a good teacher? What's the name again? Michael, you see, I don't know how your operational definition of not being academically good. I don't know your precise definition, but the meaning I'm getting from your message is that your student is not flowing with you based on whatever that you are teaching. And I don't know the kind of information you gathered, the kind of guidance you give before straight away putting the person to become a mechanic. Whether it was the person's interest, Because there are so many things that we put in place, even if the way you are operationalizing your academic and academically good is what I think. We need to do more before we can put people into certain occupations or certain trade. Because they need to be interested in it. They need to have the passion for it. And sometimes there are little things that we don't do before we just say people are not academically good. Nobody was born stupid. Because even now, morons are being trained to do something better. So it may be that we are not developing the skill to help people. That's why we said students should be allowed to progress at their own pace. You may be expecting the child to do more within a very short time, but that child can do better within a long time. So it depends on the angle you are picking it from. So I can't say you are a good teacher or not a good teacher for now. All right, thank you very much. Another message is here. Let's see. Good morning, sir. Mercy from Arts Department. Please, sir, what do you mean by relatively permanent change in behavior? Okay, what we mean is that when you say you have learned, whatever change in behavior that you are going to put up should not be a 9-day wonder. It should be something that can be exhibited for a longer time. That's the meaning of relatively permanent. We are using the word, we are qualifying the permanent with relatively because we can learn to unlearn. So you can put up a change in behavior for some time, but truth say, once you've not gone to your maker, you are still having a life, you can go through some experiences and practice, and then you change that old one. But when we say you have learned, whatever behavior you are putting up now should at least stand some for some longer period. I keep on telling my students in class that if you don't know how to approach a lady, and then you go and take some alombo, some shots to get some confidence, and then you meet the lady and start talking anyhow, the following day when the alombo is not there, the moment you see the lady coming, you run away. You've not learned anything. You did that under the influence of alcohol. That is not learning. But if really you have learned, any time you meet, you should be able to exhibit that boldness. That is it. That's the meaning of the relatively permanent that we are talking about. All right, thank you, Mercy. We also have, who is also there? You have Raymond from Mathematics Department. If a teacher puts up a behavior which is driving students away from him and realize it and change to a better one, now causing students to come to him, it's a type of negative reinforcement. Hey, is it a type of negative reinforcement? Let me go over. The teacher was putting up a behavior. That was doing what? Making students move away from him. And now realize and change. And students are now causing students to come to him. Is it type of... All right. Michael, maybe I may clarify this. We are looking at, when we talk of learning, we don't learn for others. The change in behavior, you should exhibit it. So you, the learner, the teacher can also be a learner and change behavior. So if the teacher has learned through experiences and then there has been a change in behavior, that is the teacher learning. But the way you are relating it, when we talk of reinforcement, you, the teacher, you are facilitating learning. You set goals for yourself. You expect certain desired behavior that the student should put up. So when you observe that the student is putting up that desired behavior, you reinforce so that it will strengthen the behavior. The student will continue to put up that desired behavior. Then that will come about bringing the change in behavior we are all talking about, referred to as learning. So we reinforce a desired behavior, but we punish to decrease undesired behavior. That is the point. All right. Then, more messages. We have, good morning, sir. I'm Patrick from Music Department. Please, does the negative things in the environment that affect changes in an individual's behavior be classified under behavioral theory. I think there are some behaviors that punishment or reinforcement cannot change. maybe you are only narrowing the scope of reinforcement and punishment, because we use both to shape behavior. So if you say that there are some behaviors that, then maybe it's in the spiritual world, but within the physical environment, we can't reinforce or we can't punish to shape. We are talking about to shape a behavior. We can punish or reinforce to shape a behavior. Okay. Then you also have another one from No Name. Is it true to say that behavior that is followed by positive consequences is weakened? No. If the behavior is followed by what you are terming as positive consequences, then that one will be positive reinforcer. It means that you want that person to continue putting up such a behavior. Even go back to your home. If you have a little child in your home, and that child should slap you as a senior brother, and then anytime the child will slap you, you laugh. What do you think the child will continue to do? Because you are laughing, the child will see the slapping to be part of the fun. So always when you are sitting, the child will like to slap you. So before you realize, the child will go to school and then you extend it to slapping other people. That will be the child's behavior. So if you are talking about the positive thing, that is positive reinforcer. Because you want that child to continue to do what he or she is doing. So that is how it is. So the positive consequences you are talking about will not weaken the behavior, but rather it will increase the behavior. Okay. Then we also have another one here. I am Oko Richmond from Counseling Psychology Department. Sir, I want a more clarification on the negative reinforcement and positive punishment, because in the senior high level, positive punishment are termed to be rewarded. Come again. Positive punishment attempt to be rewarded. I'm not very clear, but you said you want clarification of negative reinforcement and then what, positive punishment. All right. Okay. We said we reinforce. Listen, let me clear this. We reinforce to increase a behavior. So whether it is positive or negative, the focus is to increase a behavior. So when you remove something which is not pleasant to the learner, after the learner putting up a desired behavior, that is what we refer to as negative reinforcement. You are removing something, taking away something which is not pleasant to the learner, after the learner putting up a desired behavior. You are removing that unpleasant thing because you want the child to continue putting up the desired behavior. And because that event is not pleasant to the learner will continue to do the good thing so that you will not face that unpleasant event. If all children are standing in class, nobody wants to stand and then listen to whatever instruction that you are taking the child through. So if the condition is that if you contribute, you will sit down. Everybody would like to contribute so that you will not face that unpleasant situation of standing. That is what we mean by the negative reinforcement. Just an example. I'm not saying that's a good practice for a teacher to do. The child don't want to stand, so you continue to contribute so that you will feel comfortable sitting. So you are taking away something unpleasant to the learner when the learner puts up a desired behavior. That is negative reinforcement. But when we talk of positive punishment, you are adding something unpleasant after undesired behavior. So a child will do something which is not good in class that you don't expect the child to do. Then you add a cane. The cane is not pleasant. So that one will be positive punishment. You are adding that cane, you are beating that child, it's not pleasant to the child. And what you want to do is that to reduce that behavior that the child put up. So that becomes positive punishment. So if you look at the whether positive punishment or positive reinforcement, it's adding something. The negative is removing something. But punishment is to reduce undesired behavior. Reinforcement is to increase a desired behavior. That is the point. Okay. A text message here. I am Ose Puku from Economics Department. Please, I want to ask how we are to discipline students as caning is now prohibited apart from deducting marks. Oh, okay. So now that they are saying don't cane, you want to see how you can discipline students. We have so many ways of disciplining students. But the first point is that if we really create the right environment, as the whole curriculum is expecting us to do. If we really create the right interest in the children, whatever that we do, if the school environment is favorable to the child understands why he or she is coming to school, why he or she is learning the subject that you are teaching that child, issue of caning will not even come in. I keep on asking people that when we were in school and they were caning us, some people were in the proper international school. I'm not talking about international wooden school in the villages, no. The proper one, the when we say international school. Those children were not keen. But they are the children who are doing very well now, controlling those of us who were keen. So if the kings were doing something better, why is it that we are not doing that? It will bring about some short-time effects. But in the long time, it won't mean anything. So we need to create the right environment, because if a child is interested in your course and the child should even put up a bad behavior, and you tell the child that because you have put up a bad behavior today, I won't let you sit in my class, you realize that the child will even cry that today I'm missing this class, I'm going to lose a lot. So that behavior that the child put up, the child will not put up that behavior again. So it's a matter of creating the right environment. The concept of discipline is broad. And when people understand what they are doing and why they are doing what they are doing, they are focused and they won't go against some of the things that we think about. You see, when you even find yourself in a school, go to some of these our JHS schools, the same crop of children, different teachers who go to class, they behave differently. Maybe the music teacher will come, there's discipline in the class. Mathematics teacher will come, there's chaos. The same children. It's because of the kind of environment that the music teacher has created. So the children know that when it's time for music, it's this and it's that and it's that, and we benefit from it this way. And we want it, so we need to comport so that we will benefit. But the math teacher will come, and mathematics, that's why I'm using it as a negative. So the math people don't be offended because I'm into it. The math teacher will come and he wants the children to believe that mathematics is full of formulas, which they don't even know when they are going to use in their daily life. Why wouldn't they fuck up for you to cane them? So it is the environment. It is the environment. Thank you very much, Ose Poku. As we are getting close to the end of the radio lecture, so the lines, we have 0503-923158. You can call, you can WhatsApp, you can text 0503-923158. We also have 0332-320201. 0332-320201. You can also join us Facebook page, Radio Windy Bay 98.3 FM or university homepage www.uew.edu.gh. We have WhatsApp message here. Does spelling a pleasant stimulus with a fear invoking object or situation in order to strengthen and increase behavior describe negative reinforcement? Let me go over. Does pairing a pleasant stimulus with a fear invoking object or situation in order to strengthen and increase behavior describe negative reinforcement? You see, when we say negative reinforcement, we are talking about removing something which is unpleasant to the learner after a desired behavior. So if you say a pleasant stimulus, then we are now in the realm of positive reinforcement. If you say a pleasant stimulus, because it's pleasant to the child, so the child likes it, so the child will put up a behavior so that it will continue. But if you are saying that there's something that the child is afraid of, because I'm seeing some fear evoking objects, if there's something the child is afraid of, and if the child should put up a behavior, you take away that and that fear, because that fear is unpleasant, then you are in the realm of negative reinforcement. Because the child will continue to do the good thing so that that so-called fear-evoking object will not appear, which is not pleasant to the child. So you are combining two things here, but you ended up saying that to strengthen or increase a behavior, and we reinforce to strengthen or increase a behavior. All right, thank you very much. I think we are getting close to the end of the period. It's getting to 8 o'clock. This morning, we looked at the behaviorism paradigm and its application in education. We talked about how the behaviorists look at learning, how they explain learning. And I mentioned that all these things came up as a result of some experiments that were conducted by some of these behaviorists. We can't talk about behaviorism without mentioning Watson, Pavlov, Skinner. And these ones we will go deep when next semester we start doing psychology of human development and learning. But the broad idea is that what the behaviorists believe in is that they are much interested in the observable and measurable aspects of human behavior. They are very much interested, and they are interested in stimulus response associations. When we talk of stimulus, we are referring to events in the environment that we use our sense receptacles to pick, and then we respond to them. And the more we associate those events with those responses, that will bring about that change in behavior that we refer to as learning. So to the behaviorists, we can shape behavior using reinforcement and punishment. Then we talked about reinforcement. We say we reinforce to strengthen or increase a desired behavior. And we have positive reinforcers, we have negative reinforcers. And then we said for positive reinforcers, when we add something favorable after a desired behavior is put up. So you go to school, a child will contribute. You expect a child to contribute, a child will contribute. We praise the child, we reward the child. That is favorable. So the child will continue to contribute positively. That will bring about the change in behavior. Sometimes there are things that which are not pleasant to the child. When the child puts up a good behavior, we remove those unpleasant situations. All in the name of making sure that the child will continue to put up that good behavior. That is negative reinforcement. Then we also said that we punish to decrease undesired behavior. We punish to decrease undesired behavior. And when we talk of positive punishment, when you are adding something unfavorable to the learner after showing up that behavior which is undesirable. So those days, a child will put up a behavior we don't expect the child to put up. We cane that child. No one likes caning. That is positive punishment. And when we talk of negative punishment, when you take away something which is favorable from the learner after putting up that bad behavior, in quote, then we refer to that one as negative punishment, because that thing is favorable to the child. The child will not want to lose that favorable thing, so he will stop doing the wrong thing. That is what we refer to as the negative punishment. Then we ended up with some of the educational implications. We said we need to present our information gradually, little by little, from simple to complex. We should build on the previous knowledge that people have. We need to also encourage participation, learner participation. We need to give feedback. So we mentioned all this, and then we also said that our instructional objectives should focus on performance behavior. People should do more. The more they do, the more they understand. The more they understand, the more they put up that behavior that we are referring to as a change in behavior that we refer to as learning. So basically this morning, that is what we were able to go through. And we hope that when we meet in our various lecture theaters, those who are not able to call, those who are not able to send messages, whatever questions that you have, you will bring it there for us to discuss. Then we continue with the other paradigms. Thank you for listening. We'll meet at the various lecture halls.